Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. This Time is Different, 8 Centuries of Financial Folly, by Carmen M. Reinhart and Kenneth S. Rogoff. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Preface. This book provides a quantitative history of financial crises in their various guises. Our basic message is simple. We have been here before. No matter how different the last financial frenzy or crisis always appears, there are usually remarkable similarities with past experience from other countries and from history. Recognizing these analogies and precedents is an essential step toward improving our global financial system, both to reduce the risk of future crisis and to better handle catastrophes when they happen. If there is one common theme to the vast range of crises we consider in this audiobook, it is that excessive debt accumulation, whether it be by the government, banks, corporations, or consumers, often poses greater systemic risks than it seems during a boom. Infusions of cash can make a government look like it is providing greater growth to its economy than it really is. Private sector borrowing binges can inflate housing and stock prices far beyond their long-run sustainable levels and make banks seem more stable and profitable than they really are. Such large-scale debt buildups pose risks because they make an economy vulnerable to crises of confidence, particularly when debt is short-term and needs to be constantly refinanced. Debt-fueled booms all too often provide false affirmation of a government's policies, a financial institution's ability to make outsized profits, or a country's standard of living. Most of these booms end badly. Of course, debt instruments are crucial to all economies, ancient and modern, but balancing the risk and opportunities of debt is always a challenge policymakers, investors, and ordinary citizens must never forget. In this book, we study a number of different types of financial crises. They include sovereign defaults, which occur when a government fails to meet payments on its external or domestic debt obligations, or both. Then there are banking crises, such as those the world has experienced in spades in the late 2000s. In a typical major bank crisis, a nation finds that a significant part of its banking sector has become insolvent after heavy investment losses, banking panics, or both. Another important class of crises consists of exchange rate crises, such as those that plagued Asia, Europe, and Latin America in the 1990s. In the quintessential exchange rate crisis, the value of a country's currency falls precipitously, often despite a government's guarantee that it will not allow this to happen under any circumstances. We also consider crises marked by bouts of very high inflation. Needless to say, unexpected increases in inflation are the de facto equivalent of outright default. For inflation allows all debtors, including the government, to repay their debts in currency that has much less purchasing power than it did when the loans were made. In much of the book, we will explore these crises separately. But crises often occur in clusters. In the penultimate text chapter of this audiobook, we will look at situations such as the Great Depression of the 1930s and the latest worldwide financial crisis, in which crises occur in bunches and on a global scale. Of course, financial crises are nothing new. They have been around since the development of money and financial markets. Many of the earliest crises were driven by currency debasements that occurred when the monarch of a country reduced the gold or silver content of the coin of the realm to finance budget shortfalls often prompted by wars. Technological advances have long since eliminated a government's need to clip coins to fill a budget deficit. but financial crises have continued to thrive through the ages, and they plague countries to this day. Most of our focus in this audiobook is on two particular forms of crises that are particularly relevant today: sovereign debt crises and banking crises. Both have histories that span centuries and cut across regions. Sovereign debt crises were once commonplace among the now advanced economies that appear to have graduated from periodic bouts of government insolvency. In emerging markets, however, recurring or serial default remains a chronic and serious disease. Banking crises, in contrast, remain a recurring problem everywhere. They are an equal opportunity menace, affecting rich and poor countries alike. Our banking crisis investigation takes us on a tour from bank runs and bank failures in Europe during the Napoleonic Wars to the recent global financial crises that began with the U.S. subprime crisis of 2007. Our aim here is to be expansive, systematic, and quantitative. Our empirical analysis covers 66 countries over nearly 8 centuries. Many important books have been written about the history of international financial crises, perhaps the most famous of which is Kindleberger's 1989 book, Manias, Panics, and Crashes. By and large, however, these earlier works take an essentially narrative approach, fortified by relatively sparse data. Here, by contrast, we build our analysis around data culled from a massive database that encompasses the entire world and goes back as far as 12th century China and medieval Europe. The core life of this audiobook is contained in the largely simple tables and figures in which these data are presented, rather than in narratives of personalities, politics, and negotiations. We trust that our visual quantitative history of financial crises is no less compelling than the earlier narrative approach, and we hope that it may open new vistas for policy analysis and research. Above all, our emphasis is on looking at long spans of history to catch sight of rare events that are all too often forgotten, although they turn out to be far more common and similar than people seem to think. Indeed, analysts, policymakers, and even academic economists have an unfortunate tendency to view recent experience through the narrow window opened by standard data sets, typically based on a narrow range of experience in terms of countries and time periods. A large fraction of the academic and policy literature on debt and default draws conclusions based on data collected since 1980, in no small part because such data are the most readily accessible. This approach would be fine except for the fact that financial crises have much longer cycles, and a data set that covers 25 years simply cannot give one an adequate perspective on the risks of alternative policies and investments. An event that was rare in that 25-year span may not be all that rare when placed in a longer historical context. After all, a researcher stands only a 1 in 4 chance of observing a 100-year flood in 25 years' worth of data. To even begin to think about such events, one needs to compile data for several centuries. Of course, that is precisely our aim here. In addition, standard data sets are greatly limited in several other important respects, especially in regard to their coverage of the types of government debt. In fact, as we shall see, historical data on domestically issued government debt is remarkably difficult to obtain for most countries, which have often been little more transparent than modern-day banks with their off-balance sheet transactions and other accounting shenanigans. The foundations of our analysis are built on a comprehensive new database for studying international debt and banking crises, inflation, and currency crashes and debasements. The data come from Africa, Asia, Europe, Latin America, North America, and Oceania. Data from 66 countries in all, as previously noted, plus selected data for a number of other countries. The range of variables encompasses, among many other dimensions, external and domestic debt, trade, National income, inflation, exchange rates, interest rates, and commodity prices. The data coverage goes back more than 800 years, to the date of independence for most countries, and well into the colonial period for several. Of course, we recognize that the exercises and illustrations that we provide here can only scratch the surface of what a data set of this scope and scale can potentially unveil. Unfortunately, conveying the details of the data is not essential to understanding the main message of this audiobook. We have been here before. The instruments of financial gain and loss have varied over the ages, as have the types of institutions that have expanded mightily only to fail massively. But financial crises follow a rhythm of boom and bust through the ages. Countries, institutions, and financial instruments may change across time, but human nature does not. As we will discuss in the final chapters of this audiobook, the financial crisis of the late 2000s that originated in the United States and spread across the globe, which we refer to as the Second Great Contraction, is only the latest manifestation of this pattern. We take up the latest crisis in the final four chapters before the conclusion, in which we review what we have learned. The listener should find the material in chapters 13 to 16 relatively straightforward and self-contained. We show that in the run-up to the subprime crisis, standard indicators for the United States, such as asset price inflation, rising leverage, large sustained current account deficits, and a slowing trajectory of economic growth, exhibited virtually all the signs of a country on the verge of a financial crisis, indeed a severe one. This view of the way into a crisis is sobering. We show that the way out can be quite perilous as well. The aftermath of systemic banking crises involves a protracted and pronounced contraction in economic activity and puts significant strains on government resources. The first part of the audiobook gives precise definitions of concepts describing crises and discusses the data underlying the audiobook. In the construction of our data set, we have built heavily on the work of earlier scholars. However, our data set also includes a considerable amount of new material from diverse primary and secondary sources. In addition to providing a systematic dating of external debt and exchange rate crises, the appendixes in this book catalog dates for domestic inflation and banking crises. The dating of sovereign defaults on domestic, mostly local, currency debt is one of the more novel features that rounds out our study of financial crises. The payoff to this scrutiny comes in the remaining parts of the audiobook, which apply these concepts to our expanded global data set. Part 2 turns our attention to government debt, chronicling hundreds of episodes of default by sovereign nations on their debt to external creditors. These debt crises have ranged from those related to mid-14th century loans by Florentine financiers to England's Edward III, to German merchant bankers' loans, to Spain's Habsburg monarchy, to massive loans made by, mostly, New York bankers, to Latin America during the 1970s. Although we find that during the modern era, sovereign external default crises have been far more concentrated in emerging markets than banking crises have been, we nevertheless emphasize that even sovereign defaults on external debt have been an almost universal rite of passage for every country as it has matured from an emerging market economy to an advanced developed economy. This process of economic, financial, social, and political development can take centuries. Indeed, in its early years as a nation-state, France defaulted on its external debt no fewer than 8 times, as we show in Chapter 6. Spain defaulted a mere 6 times prior to 1800, but with 7 defaults in the 19th century, surpassed France for a total of 13 episodes. Thus, when today's European powers were going through the emerging market phase of development, they experienced recurrent problems with external debt default, just as many emerging markets do today. From 1800 until well after World War II, Greece found itself virtually in continual default, and Austria's record is in some ways even more stunning. Although the development of international capital markets was quite limited prior to 1800, we nevertheless catalog the numerous defaults of France, Portugal, Prussia, Spain, and the early Italian city-states. At the edge of Europe, Egypt, Russia, and Turkey have histories of chronic default as well. One of the fascinating questions raised by our audiobook is why a relatively small number of countries, such as Australia and New Zealand, Canada, Denmark, Thailand, and the United States, have managed to avoid defaults on central government debt to foreign creditors, whereas far more countries have been characterized by serial default on their external debts. Asian and African financial crises are far less researched than those of Europe and Latin America. Indeed, the widespread belief that modern sovereign default is a phenomenon confined to Latin America and a few poorer European countries is heavily colored by the paucity of research on other regions. As we shall see, pre-communist China repeatedly defaulted on international debts, and modern-day India and Indonesia both defaulted in the 1960s, long before the first post-war round of Latin defaults. Post-colonial Africa has a default record that looks as if it is set to outstrip that of any previously emerging market region. Overall, we find that a systematic quantitative examination of the post-colonial default records of Asia and Africa debunks the notion that most countries have avoided the perils of sovereign default. The near universality of default becomes abundantly clear in Part 2, when we begin to use the data set to paint the history of default and financial crises in broad strokes using tables and figures. One point that certainly jumps out from the analysis is that the fairly recent, that is 2003 to 2008, quiet spell in which governments have generally honored their debt obligations is far from the norm. The history of domestic public debt, that is, internally issued government debt, in emerging markets in particular, has largely been ignored by contemporary scholars and policymakers, even by official data providers, such as the International Monetary Fund, who seem to view its emergence at the beginning of the 21st century as a stunning new phenomenon. Yet, as we will show in Part 3, domestic public debt in emerging markets has been extremely significant during many periods and, in fact, potentially helps resolve a host of puzzles pertaining to episodes of high inflation and default. We view the difficulties one experiences in finding data on government debt as just one facet of the general low level of transparency with which most governments maintain their books. Think of the implicit guarantees given to the massive mortgage lenders that ultimately added trillions to the effective size of the U.S. national debt in 2008. The trillions of dollars in off-balance sheet transactions engaged in by the Federal Reserve, and the implicit guarantees involved in taking bad assets off bank balance sheets, not to mention unfunded pension and medical liabilities. Lack of transparency is endemic in government debt, but the difficulty of finding basic historical data on central government debt is almost comical. Part 3 also offers a first attempt to catalog episodes of overt default on and rescheduling of domestic public debt across more than a century. Because so much of the history of domestic debt has largely been forgotten by scholars, not surprisingly, so too has its history of default. This phenomenon appears to be somewhat rarer than external default, but is far too common to justify the extreme assumption that governments always honor the nominal face value of domestic debt, an assumption that dominates the economics literature. When overt default on domestic debt does occur, it appears to occur in situations of greatest duress than those that lead to pure external default, in terms of both an implosion of output and a marked escalation of inflation. Part 4 broadens our discussion to include crises related to banking, currency, and inflation. Until very recently, the study of banking crises has typically focused either on earlier historical experiences in advanced countries, mainly the banking panics before World War II, or on modern-day experiences in emerging markets. This dichotomy has perhaps been shaped by the belief that for advanced economies, destabilizing, systemic, multi-country financial crises are a relic of the past. Of course, the recent global financial crises emanating out of the United States and Europe has dashed this misconception, albeit at great social cost. The fact is that banking crises have long plagued rich and poor countries alike. We reach this conclusion after examining banking crises ranging from Denmark's financial panic during the Napoleonic Wars to the recent first global financial crisis of the 21st century. The incidence of banking crises proves to be remarkably similar in the high and the middle to low income countries. Banking crises almost invariably lead to sharp declines in tax revenues, as well as significant increases in government spending, a share of which is presumably dissipative. On average, government debt rises by 86% during the 3 years following a banking crisis. These indirect fiscal consequences are thus an order of magnitude larger than the usual costs of bank bailouts. Episodes of treacherously high inflation are another recurrent theme. No emerging market country in history has managed to escape bouts of high inflation. Indeed, there is a very strong parallel between our proposition that few countries have avoided serial default on external debt and the proposition that few countries have avoided serial bouts of high inflation. Even the United States has had a checkered history, including in 1779, when the inflation rate approached 200%. Early on across the world, as already noted, the main device for defaulting on government obligations was that of debasing the content of the coinage. Modern currency presses are just a technologically advanced and more efficient approach to achieving the same end. As a consequence, a clear inflationary bias throughout history emerges. Starting in the 20th century, inflation spiked radically higher. Since then, inflation crises have stepped up to a higher plateau. Unsurprisingly, then, the more modern period also has seen a higher incidence of exchange rate crashes and larger median changes in currency values. Perhaps more surprising, and made visible only by a broader historical context, are the earlier episodes of pronounced exchange rate instability, notably during the Napoleonic Wars. Just as financial crises have common macroeconomic antecedents in asset prices, economic activity, external indicators, and so on, so do common patterns appear in the sequencing, or the temporal order, in which crises unfold, the final subject of Part 4. The concluding chapter offers some reflections on crises, policy, and pathways for academic study. What is certainly clear is that again and again, countries, banks, individuals, and firms take on excessive debt in good times without enough awareness of the risks that will follow when the inevitable recession hits. Many players in the global financial system often dig a debt hole far larger than they can reasonably expect to escape from, most famously the United States and its financial system in the late 2000s. Government and government-guaranteed debt, which, due to deposit insurance, often implicitly includes bank debt, is certainly the most problematic, for it can accumulate massively and for long periods without being put in check by markets, especially where regulation prevents them from effectively doing so. Although private debt certainly plays a key role in many crises, government debt is far more often the unifying problem across the wide range of financial crises we examine. As we stated earlier, the fact that basic data on domestic debt is so opaque and difficult to obtain is proof that governments will go to great lengths to hide their books when things are going wrong, just as financial institutions have done in the contemporary financial crisis. We see a major role for international policymaking organizations, such as the International Monetary Fund, in providing government debt accounts that are more transparent than those available today. Our immersion in the details of crises that have arisen over the past 8 centuries and in data on them has led us to conclude that the most commonly repeated and most expensive investment advice ever given in the boom, just before a financial crisis, stems from the perception that this time is different. That advice, that the old rules of valuation no longer apply, is usually followed up with vigor. Financial professionals, and all too often government leaders, explain that we are doing things better than before. We are smarter, and we have learned from past mistakes. Each time, society convinces itself that the current boom, unlike the many booms that preceded catastrophic collapses in the past, is built on sound fundamentals, structural reforms, technological innovation, and good policy. Given the sweeping data on which this audiobook has been built, it is simply not possible to provide textual context to all the hundreds of episodes the data encompasses. Nevertheless, the tables and figures speak very powerfully for themselves of the phenomenal recurrent nature of the problem. We hope that the weight of evidence in this audiobook will give future policymakers and investors a bit more pause before next they declare, "This time is different." It almost never is. Preamble: Some Initial Intuitions on Financial Fragility and the Fickle Nature of Confidence. This audiobook summarizes the long history of financial crises in their many guises across many countries. Before heading into the deep waters of experience, this chapter will attempt to sketch an economic framework to help the listener understand why financial crises tend to be both unpredictable and damaging. As the audiobook unfolds, we will take other opportunities to guide interested listeners through the related academic literature when it is absolutely critical to our story. Rest assured that these are only short detours, and those unconcerned with economic theory as an engine of discovery can bypass these byways. As we shall argue, economic theory proposes plausible reasons that financial markets, particularly ones reliant on leverage, which means that they have thin capital compared to the amount of assets at stake, can be quite fragile and subject to crises of confidence. Unfortunately, theory gives little guidance on the exact timing or duration of these crises, which is why we focus so on experience. Perhaps more than anything else, failure to recognize the precariousness and fickleness of confidence, especially in cases in which large short-term debts need to be rolled over continuously, is the key factor that gives rise to the "this time is different" syndrome. Highly indebted governments, banks, or corporations can seem to be merrily rolling along for an extended period when, bang, confidence collapses, lenders disappear, and a crisis hits. The simplest and most familiar example is bank runs, which we take up in more detail in the chapter on banking crises. We talk about banks for two reasons. First, that is the route along which the academic literature developed. Second, much of our historical data set applies to the borrowing of banks and of governments. Other large and liquid participants in credit markets are relatively new entrants to the world of finance. However, our examples are quite illustrative of a broader phenomenon of financial fragility. Many of the same general principles apply to these market actors, whether they be government-sponsored enterprises, investment banks, or money market mutual funds. Banks traditionally borrow at short term, that is, they borrow in the form of deposits that can be redeemed on relatively short notice. But the loans they make mostly have a far longer maturity and can be difficult to convert into cash on short notice. For example, a bank financing the expansion of a local hardware store might be reasonably confident of repayment in the long run as the store expands its business and revenues. But early in the expansion, the bank may have no easy way to call in the loan. The store owner simply has insufficient revenues, particularly if forced to make payments on principal as well as interest. A bank with a healthy deposit base and a large portfolio of illiquid loans may well have bright prospects over the long term. However, if for some reason depositors all try to withdraw their funds at once, say because of panic based on a false rumor that the bank has lost money gambling on exotic mortgages, trouble ensues. Absent a way to sell its illiquid loan portfolio, the bank might simply not be able to pay off its panicked depositors. Such was the fate of the banks in the classic movies It's a Wonderful Life and Mary Poppins. Those movies were rooted in reality. Many banks have shared this fate, particularly when the government has not fully guaranteed bank deposits. The most famous recent example of a bank run is the run on the United Kingdom's Northern Rock Bank. Panicked depositors, not satisfied with the British government's partial insurance scheme, formed long queues in September 2007. The broadening panic eventually forced the British government to take over the bank and more fully back its liabilities. Other borrowers, not just banks, can suffer from a crisis of confidence. During the financial crisis that started in the United States in 2007, huge financial giants in the shadow banking system outside regulated banks suffered similar problems. Although they borrowed mainly from banks and other financial institutions, their vulnerability was the same. As confidence in the investments they had made fell, lenders increasingly refused to roll over their short-term loans, and they were forced to throw assets on the market at fire sale prices. Distressed sales drove prices down further, leading to further losses and downward spiraling confidence. Eventually, the U.S. government had to step in to try to prop up the market. The drama is still unfolding, and the price tag for resolution continues to mount. Governments can be subject to the same dynamics of fickle expectations that can destabilize banks. This is particularly so when a government borrows from external lenders over whom it has relatively little influence. Most government investments directly or indirectly involve the long-run growth potential of the country and its tax base, but these are highly illiquid assets. Suppose, for example, that a country has a public debt burden that seems manageable, given its current tax revenues, growth projections, and market interest rates. If the market becomes concerned that a populist fringe candidate is going to win the next election and raise spending so much that the debt will become difficult to manage, investors may suddenly balk at rolling over short-term debt at rates the country can manage. A credit crisis unfolds. Although these kinds of scenarios are not everyday events, over the long course of history and the broad range of countries we cover in this audiobook, such financial crises occur all too frequently. Why cannot big countries, or even the world as a whole, find a way to put a stop to crises of confidence, at least premature ones? It is possible, but there is a rub. Suppose a world government agency provided expansive deposit insurance to protect every worthy borrower from panics. Say there was a supersized version of the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, today's main multilateral lender that aims to help emerging markets when they run into liquidity crises. The problem is that if one provides insurance to everyone everywhere with no conditions, some players are going to misbehave. If the IMF lent too much with too few conditions, the IMF itself would be bankrupt in short order, and financial crises would be unchecked. Complete insurance against crises is neither feasible nor desirable. Exactly this conundrum will face the global financial community in the wake of the latest financial crisis, with the IMF's lending resources having been increased fourfold in response to the crisis, while at the same time lending conditionality has been considerably relaxed. What does economic theory have to say about countries' vulnerability to financial crises? For concreteness, let us focus for now on governments, the main source of the crises examined in this audiobook. Economic theory tells us that if a government is sufficiently frugal, it is not terribly vulnerable to crises of confidence. A government does not have to worry too much about debt crises if it consistently runs fiscal surpluses, which happens when tax receipts exceed expenditures, maintains relatively low debt levels, mostly borrows at longer-term maturities, say 10 years or more, and does not have too many hidden off-balance sheet guarantees. If, in contrast, a government runs large deficits year after year, concentrating its borrowing at shorter-term maturities of, say, 1 year or less, it becomes vulnerable, perhaps even at debt-burdened levels that seemingly should be quite manageable. Of course, an ill-intentioned government could try to reduce its vulnerability by attempting to issue large amounts of long-term debt. But most likely, markets will quickly catch on and charge extremely high interest rates on any long-dated borrowing. Indeed, a principal reason that some governments choose to borrow at shorter maturities instead of longer maturities is precisely so that they can benefit from lower interest rates as long as confidence lasts. Economic theory tells us that it is precisely the fickle nature of confidence, including its dependence on the public's expectation of future events, that makes it so difficult to predict the timing of debt crises. High debt levels lead, in many mathematical economics models, to multiple equilibria, in which the debt level might be sustained or might not be. Economists do not have a terribly good idea of what kinds of events shift confidence and of how to concretely assess confidence vulnerability. What one does see, again and again, in the history of financial crises is that when an accident is waiting to happen, it eventually does. When countries become too deeply indebted, they are headed for trouble. When debt-fueled asset price explosions seem too good to be true, they probably are. But the exact timing can be very difficult to guess, and a crisis that seems imminent can sometimes take years to ignite. Such was certainly the case of the United States in the late 2000s. As we show in Chapter 13, all the red lights were blinking in the run-up to the crisis. But until the accident, many financial leaders in the United States, and indeed many academics, were still arguing that this time is different. We would like to note that our caution about excessive debt burdens and leverage for governments is different from the admonitions of the traditional public choice literature of Buchanan and others. The traditional public finance literature warns about the short-sightedness of governments in running fiscal deficits and their chronic failure to weigh the long-run burden that servicing debt will force on their citizens. In fact, excessive debt burdens often generate problems in the nearer term, precisely because investors may have doubts about the country's will to finance the debt over the longer term. The fragility of debt can be every bit as great a problem as its long-term tax burden, at times even greater. Similar fragility problems arise in other crisis contexts that we will consider in this audiobook. One of the lessons of the 1980s and 1990s is that countries maintaining fixed or highly managed exchange rate regimes are vulnerable to sudden crises of confidence. Speculative attacks on fixed exchange rates can blow up overnight seemingly stable, long-lived regimes. During the period of the successful fix, there was always plenty of "this time is different" commentary. But then, as in the case of Argentina in December 2001, All the confidence can collapse in a puff of smoke. There is a fundamental link to debt, however. As Krugman famously showed, exchange rate crises often have their roots in a government's unwillingness to adopt fiscal and monetary policies consistent with maintaining a fixed exchange rate. If speculators realize the government is eventually going to run out of the resources needed to back the currency, they will all be looking to time their move out of the currency in anticipation of the eventual crash. Public debts do not always have to be explicit. Contingent government guarantees have been at the crux of many a crisis. Certainly, countries have ways of making themselves less vulnerable to crises of confidence, short of simply curtailing their borrowing and leverage. Economic theory suggests that greater transparency helps. As the listener shall hear later on, governments tend to be anything but transparent when it comes to borrowing. And as the financial crisis of the late 2000s shows, private borrowers are often little better unless government regulation forces them to be more transparent. A country with stronger legal and regulatory institutions can certainly borrow more. Indeed, many scholars consider Britain's development of superior institutions for making debt repayment credible a key to its military and development successes in the 18th and 19th centuries. But even good institutions and a sophisticated financial system can run into problems if faced with enough strains, as the United States has learned so painfully in the most recent crisis. Finally, there is the question of why financial crises tend to be so painful, a topic we take up mainly in the introduction to Chapter 10 on banking crises. In brief, most economies, even relatively poor ones, depend on the financial sector to channel money from savers, typically consumers, to investment projects around the economy. If a crisis paralyzes the banking system, it is very difficult for an economy to resume normal economic activity. Ben Bernanke famously advanced bank collapse as an important reason that the Great Depression of the 1930s lasted so long and hit so hard. So financial crises, particularly those that are large and difficult to resolve, can have profound effects. Again, as in the case of multiple equilibria and financial fragility, there is a large economic theory literature on the topic. This strong connection between financial markets and real economic activity, particularly when financial markets cease to function, is what has made so many of the crises we consider in this audiobook such spectacular historic events. Consider, in contrast, the collapse of the tech stock bubble in 2001. Although technology stocks soared and collapsed, the effect on the real economy was only the relatively mild recession of 2001. Bubbles are far more dangerous when they are fueled by debt, as in the case of the global housing price explosion of the early 2000s. Surely, the second great contraction, as we term the financial crisis of the late 2000s, which has spread to nearly every region, will have a profound effect on economics, particularly the study of linkages between financial markets and the real economy. We hope some of the facts laid out in this audiobook will be helpful in framing the problems that the new theories need to explain, not just for the recent crisis, but for the multitude of crises that have occurred in the past, not to mention the many that have yet to unfold. Part 1. Financial Crises, an Operational Primer. The essence of the "this time is different" syndrome is simple. It is rooted in the firmly held belief that financial crises are things that happen to other people in other countries at other times. Crises do not happen to us, here and now. We are doing things better. We are smarter. We have learned from past mistakes. The old rules of valuation no longer apply. Unfortunately, a highly leveraged economy can unwittingly be sitting with its back at the edge of a financial cliff for many years before chance and circumstance provoke a crisis of confidence that pushes it off. Chapter 1. Varieties of Crises and Their Dates. Because this audiobook is grounded in a quantitative and historical analysis of crises, it is important to begin by defining exactly what constitutes a financial crisis, as well as the methods, quantitative where possible, by which we date its beginning and end. This chapter and the two that follow lay out the basic concepts, definitions, methodology, and approach toward data collection and analysis that underpin our study of the historical international experience with almost any kind of economic crisis, be it a sovereign debt default, banking, inflation, or exchange rate crisis. Delving into precise definitions of a crisis in an initial chapter rather than simply including them in a glossary may seem somewhat tedious. But for the reader to properly interpret the sweeping historical figures and tables that follow later in this volume, it is essential to have a sense of how we delineate what constitutes a crisis and what does not. The boundaries we draw are generally consistent with the existing empirical economics literature, which by and large is segmented across the various types of crises we consider, for example, sovereign debt, exchange rate, etc. We try to highlight any cases in which results are conspicuously sensitive to small changes in our cutoff points or where we are particularly concerned about clear inadequacies in the data. This definition chapter also gives us a convenient opportunity to expand a bit more on the variety of crises we take up in this audiobook. The listener should note that the crisis markers discussed in this chapter refer to the measurement of crises within individual countries. Later on, we discuss a number of ways to think about the international dimensions of crises and their intensity and transmission, culminating in our definition of a global crisis in Chapter 16. In addition to reporting on one country at a time, our root measures of crisis thresholds report on only one type of crisis at a time. For example, exchange rate crashes, inflation, banking crises, and so on. As we emphasize, particularly in Chapter 16, different varieties of crises tend to fall in clusters, suggesting that it may be possible, in principle, to have systemic definitions of crises. But for a number of reasons, we prefer to focus on the simplest and most transparent delineation of crisis episodes, especially because doing otherwise would make it very difficult to make broad comparisons across countries and time. These definitions of crises are rooted in the existing empirical literature and referenced accordingly. We begin by discussing crises that can readily be given strict quantitative definitions, then turn to those for which we must rely on more qualitative and judgmental analysis. The concluding section defines serial default and the "this time is different" syndrome, concepts that will recur throughout the remainder of the audiobook. Crises defined by quantitative thresholds: inflation, currency crashes, and debasement. Inflation crises. We begin by defining inflation crises, both because of their universality and long historical significance, and because of the relative simplicity and clarity with which they can be identified. Because we are interested in cataloging the extent of default, through inflated debt anyway, and not only its frequency, we will attempt to mark not only the beginning of an inflation or currency crisis episode, but its duration as well. Many high inflation spells can best be described as chronic, lasting many years, sometimes dissipating and sometimes plateauing at an intermediate level before exploding. A number of studies, including our own earlier work on classifying post-World War II exchange rate arrangements, use a 12-month inflation threshold of 40% or higher, as the mark of a high inflation episode. Of course, one can argue that the effects of inflation are pernicious at much lower levels of inflation, say 10%. But the costs of sustained, moderate inflation are not well established either theoretically or empirically. In our earlier work on the post-World War II era, we chose a 40% cutoff because there is a fairly broad consensus that such levels are pernicious. We discussed general inflation trends and lower peaks where significant. Hyperinflations, inflation rates above 40% per month, are of modern vintage. As we will see in Chapter 12 on inflation crises, Hungary in 1946, Zimbabwe's recent experience notwithstanding, holds the record in our sample. For the pre-World War I period, however, even 40% per annum is too high an inflation threshold, because inflation rates were much lower then, especially before the advent of modern paper currency. Often referred to as fiat currency, because it has no intrinsic value and is worth something only because the government declares by fiat that other currencies are not legal tender in domestic transactions. The median inflation rates before World War I were well below those of the more recent period, 0.5% per annum for 1500 to 1799, and 0.71% for 1800 to 1913, in contrast with 5% for 1914 to 2006. In periods with much lower average inflation rates and little expectation of high inflation, much lower inflation rates could be quite shocking and traumatic to an economy and therefore considered crises. Thus, in this audiobook, in order to meaningfully incorporate earlier periods, we adopt an inflation crisis threshold of 20% per annum. At most of the main points at which we believe there were inflation crises, our main assertions appear to be reasonably robust relative to our choice of threshold. For example, our assertion that there was a crisis at any given point would stand up had we defined inflation crises using a lower threshold of, say, 15%, or a higher threshold of, say, 25%. Of course, given that we are making most of our data set available online, readers are free to set their own threshold for inflation or for other quantitative crisis benchmarks. Currency crashes. In order to date currency crashes, we follow a variant of an approach introduced by Jeffrey Frankel and Andrew Rose, who focus exclusively on large exchange rate depreciations and set their basic threshold, subject to some caveats, as 25% per annum. This definition is the most parsimonious, for it does not rely on other variables such as reserve losses, data governments often guard jealously, sometimes long delaying their publication, and interest rate hikes, which are not terribly meaningful in financial systems under very heavy government control, which was in fact the case for most countries until relatively recently. As with inflation, the 25% threshold that one might apply to data from the period after World War II, at least to define a severe exchange rate crisis, would be too high for the earlier period, when much smaller movements constituted huge surprises and were therefore extremely disruptive. Therefore, we define as a currency crash an annual depreciation in excess of 15%. Mirroring our treatment of inflation episodes, we are concerned here not only with the dating of the initial crash, as in Frankel and Rose, as well as Kaminsky and Reinhart, but with the full period in which annual depreciations exceeded the threshold. It is hardly surprising that the largest crashes are similar in timing and order of magnitude to the profile for inflation crises. The honor of the record currency crash, however, does not go to Hungary, as in the case of inflation, but to Greece in 1944. Currency debasement. The precursor of modern inflation and foreign exchange rate crises was currency debasement during the long era in which the principal means of exchange were metallic coins. Not surprisingly, debasements were particularly frequent and large during wars, when drastic reductions in the silver content of the currency sometimes provided sovereigns with their most important source of financing. In this book, we also date currency reforms or conversions and their magnitudes. Such conversions form a part of every hyperinflation episode in our sample. Indeed, it is not unusual to see that there were several conversions in quick succession. For example, in its struggle with hyperinflation, Brazil had no fewer than 4 currency conversions from 1986 to 1994. When we began to work on this book in terms of the magnitude of a single conversion, the record holder was China, which in 1948 had a conversion rate of 3 million to 1. Alas, by the time of its completion, that record was surpassed by Zimbabwe, with a 10 billion to 1 conversion. Conversions also follow spells of high, but not necessarily hyperinflation, and these cases are also included in our list of modern debasements. The bursting of asset price bubbles. Some quantitative methodology could be applied in dating the bursting of asset price bubbles, be they equity or real estate, which are commonplace in the run-up to banking crises. We discuss these crash episodes involving equity prices in Chapter 16 and leave real estate crises for future research. One reason we do not tackle the issue here is that price data for many key assets underlying financial crises, particularly housing prices, are extremely difficult to come by in a long-term, cross-country basis. However, our data set does include housing prices for a number of both developed and emerging market countries over the past couple of decades, which we shall exploit later in our analysis of banking crises. Crises defined by events. Banking crises and external and domestic default. In this section, we describe the criteria used in this study to date banking crises, external debt crises, and domestic debt crisis counterparts, the last of which are by far the least well-documented and understood. Here is a brief glossary of the key concepts of debt used throughout our analysis. 1. External debt. The total debt liabilities of a country with foreign creditors, both official, that is public, and private. Creditors often determine all the terms of the debt contracts, which are normally subject to the jurisdiction of the foreign creditors or to international law for multilateral credits.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.